Hello, and welcome to LMPR. This is a fictitious radio broadcast talking to the Antiguan leader, Verbird. While he has been dead for quite a few years after this broadcast, Verbird will be making an appearance, though through a person playing him. This news segment takes place a few years before he died in 1997, in a tell-all retrospect of his life. This broadcast is purely interpretation from research about what some of his responses would potentially be in a tell-all interview about the mistakes and accomplishments he made. This is not meant to offend anyone, as during this project we have tried to be as culturally sensitive as possible. Thank you and enjoy listening to LMPR.
Hello and welcome to LMPR. We are here today with an interesting guest who played a controversial role as a leader of the island nation of Antigua, Ver Cornwall Byrd Sr. Ver Byrd was considered one of the most influential Antiguans of all time, but at the time of this recording, he is dead. He is considered this because he created the ATLU, and as his time as the Prime Minister of Antigua, he fought for the underappreciated and the underpaid Antiguan and changed the fate of his country forever. With Ver Byrd being an influential figure in his country, he wasn't as clean as he seemed. Ver Byrd had drug trafficking scandals amongst affairs and his own family even turning against the very land he built. Ver Byrd is a figure who makes your stomach churn and your heart happy. What a legacy he leaves behind is for you to decide after this interview. Hello and welcome. We are here today with a man named Ver Byrd, also known more commonly as VC Byrd.
Thank you, Paul. It's good to be here.
We're really glad to have you. As of today, how old are you?
Well, it's 1997, which means I am 87 years old.
We were kind of wondering, this was kind of a long shot to ask you on the show, why did you decide to come on?
As the leader of Antigua for a good part of my life, I've made a lot of mistakes, but also I feel I've done a lot of good things. I think people would really appreciate a career retrospective of sorts from me.
Well, we're really glad you decided to come on. Tell us a little bit about your childhood.
Well, I was born in 1910 and was the fourth of five children. We didn't have a lot of money growing up. In fact, we struggled to find housing at this time, and for a good part of my childhood, I lived in a glorified shack. I never had any formal education, but decided to join the Salvation Army in the mid-30s.
We heard about this and thought it was really interesting. Is it true you became a captain of the Salvation Army at age 21?
Yep.
This being your first real leadership position, do you think it set the stage for the rest of your positions in power?
Yes, I do. And from a young age, I had a very powerful voice, and people seemed to listen to me. I've come across some articles that even describe me as having a preacher's tongue. So having a knack for politics wasn't a huge surprise to me. After my position in the Salvation Army, along with a few people with experience in leadership, I started the Antigua Trades and Labor Union, or the ATLU. Even though I was in a leadership position in the Salvation Army, the first time I was a political leader was when I was elected to be the president 4 years after the union started. The biggest goal for the union was to have the biggest employer of the island, Antigua Sugar Estates, to recognize us as a union, and to be able to negotiate wages and other things.
Well, it seems like a large endeavor. When did all these events occur?
I founded the ATLU in 1939, became the president in 1943, and finally in 1951, we got the Antigua Sugar Estates to recognize our union.
So, Antigua Sugar Estates being the largest employer of the island, how exactly did you get them to recognize your union? There has to be a lot of pushback in some political move this large.
Oh yes, there was a lot. The peak confrontation came in January of 1951 when I met with the president of Antigua Sugar Estates, Alexander Moody Stewart. I demanded that the workers, or as we called them, the cane cutters, wages were raised or we would go on strike. He was skeptical and didn't believe we would actually go on strike. There was no sugar harvest that year, and I famously said to him, "We will eat cockles in the witty witty bush," when he said we would starve without him. He eventually gave our workers the wages they deserved.
Wow, this must have been a great political move for you.
Yes, because of my name recognition after that, I started the Antigua Labor Party, and as an adjunct to the ATLU, and was eventually elected to be a member of the colonial legislature in 1945, this gave me some political pull and helped the ATLU's causes.
So, this colonial legislature, who was it comprised of?
I was one of the elected officials, but there were many unelected officials who were part of what people have deemed the plantocracy. These were wealthy men who only had the issues regarding plantation regulation at heart. Once universal suffrage was passed in 1951, my party won every seat in the parliament, per se.
So we all know from here, you were elected in 1960 to the position of Chief Minister of Antigua, and then in 1967, you became the country's first premier. Then eventually, once Antigua independence was achieved, you became Prime Minister in 1981.
Vera Byrd was a powerful man in stature and in political presence. As with all leaders, there's a great deal of controversy surrounding him. From guns and drug-running scandals to scandals in him having mistresses, he's a really good example of an ambiguous leader.
Even with all of these political savvy moves in mind, can you please explain your involvement in the drug-running scandal involving the Israeli officer?
Yeah, so one of the many scandals during my political career involved my son, Vera Byrd Jr., buying arms from Israel and then sending said arms to the Gasha drug cartel in Colombia. No formal charges ever met my son, but he resigned in his cabinet position soon after that.
And we heard something also about Russian involvement.
We let some less than legitimate organized crime groups from Russia into our country. They were involved in money laundering, drugs, arms sales, and extortion. I had some of my family members sell large amounts of our rare pink sand.
Would you accredit some of these scandals to your childhood? It seems like you had a very difficult upbringing, and being so poor, you never really learned how to deal with money or power, per se.
I realize how many mistakes I made in my career, and most of it is my own doing, but my family certainly didn't help me overcome that. I didn't come from one of the families that breed into politics like the Kennedys or the Clintons, so I didn't really have any advantage going into politics, but it doesn't excuse all of the illegal behavior that I was involved in.
Well, thank you. I think this has been really informational for our audience, but this is all the allotted time we had today. We thank you for coming on.
Yep, thanks for having me.
After listening to this interview, it's still hard to peg a man who had such a prowess and yet abused it for his inner glories. Vera Byrd's legacy was good in the beginning, even being named as a Knight of the Order of the National Hero. Yet his dark side was worse than anyone could imagine with affairs and slowly became one of the very people he set out to defeat in his younger days. Vera Byrd was the epitome of being a leader, being a tall man around 7 feet, and having a booming voice people were drawn to. Yet he betrayed the very people he set out to help, and kept it hidden. Not only that, as his family got involved in politics with him, and abused it potentially worse with his sons, with defamation, sex, and drug scandals being littered throughout their terms. Being such an ambiguous leader, it's easy to think of him as a man who corrupted Antigua, or for leading Antiguans out of the dark and into the light. The only person who can decide Vera Byrd's is the listener. Thank you for listening. I'm Jacob Tupfer for LMPR. Come back, darling. Give me another try. I'll make you satisfied.